Afternoon, everyone. Such a privilege for me to be able to welcome you this morning to our service. It has been some time since we have been able to meet together as a congregation. I'm really missing you guys. I guess I just miss the community, the sound of the singing, sharing a coffee and whatever, a laugh afterwards. And most importantly, just being able to collectively listen to God's word through Andrew's faithful preaching. So I trust that God will do his own will and that he would be working all things to his glory. As we know, he is a faithful God and loving God. So just, stay humble during this time. Stay reliant on God. Although we are sinful people, we have a very gracious and forgiving God. And let's just trust what God is doing. And also in our own prayer life, let's try and make sure that instead of praying that the coronavirus situation would just end, that we would just pray in line with God's will, that God's will would be done, that God's will would be what we desire. As Jesus prayed in the prayer to the Father, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. So yeah, difficult times, but we have a very loving God and Savior to turn to. This morning we're going to be reading and going through 1 Corinthians 11, 27 to 34. I won't read the text, I will leave that up to Andy. What I will do is ask you to please turn to Psalm 27 and we can read that together, Psalm 27. I'll give you a moment to get there. Hopefully I haven't scared away any of your children with my beard. It is a bit of a shock to some. But let's turn to God's word now and read Psalm 27 together as we incline our hearts towards God. The Lord is my light and my salvation. Whom shall I fear? The Lord is the stronghold of my life. Of whom shall I be afraid? When evildoers assail me to eat up my flesh, my adversaries and foes, it is they who stumble and fall. Though an army encamp against me, my heart shall not fear. Though war arise against me, yet I will be confident. One thing I have asked of the Lord, that I will seek after, that I may dwell in the house of the Lord all the days of my life, to gaze upon the beauty of the Lord and to inquire in his temple. For he will hide me in his shelter in the day of trouble. He will conceal me under the cover of his tent. He will lift me high upon a rock. And now my head will be lifted up above my enemies all around me. And I will offer in his tent sacrifices with shouts of joy. I will sing and make melody to the Lord. Hear, O Lord, when I cry aloud. Be gracious to me and answer me. You have said, seek my face. My heart says to you, your face, Lord, do I seek. Hide not your face from me. Turn not your servant away in anger, O you who have been my help. Cast me not off, forsake me not, O God of my salvation. For my father and my mother have forsaken me, but the Lord will take me. Take me in, teach me your way, O Lord, and lead me on a level path because of my enemies. Give me not up to the will of my adversaries, for false witnesses have risen against me, and they breathe out violence. I believe that I shall look upon the goodness of the Lord in the land of the living. Wait for the Lord, be strong, and let your heart take courage. Wait for the Lord. Just a fantastic psalm. Especially in light of what we're going through. We might not be fighting armies at the moment, but we're fighting a pandemic. But I just want to remind you that God is sovereign over all things. And so we need to rest in that. And if I can draw your attention just to one verse in the psalm. Psalm 27 verse 4. One thing have I asked of the Lord, that I will seek after, that I may dwell in the house of the Lord all the days of my life. To gaze upon the beauty of the Lord and to inquire in his temple. And it's just what struck me is the fact that through all of the things David can speak to God about, he prays first for his spiritual deliverance, not his physical deliverance. We know that this world is only temporal, and one day all things will pass away and we will all die, and that's a very, very sure fact of life. So I want to encourage you this morning to make sure that when you pray to God, you look at your own heart Look intently at your character, at your shortcomings, at your sins. Lift those up before God, knowing that He is forgiving and gracious. And then pray for your spiritual deliverance, not your physical deliverance. Of course, we can pray for that. God does heal. He has the power to heal. But just like David, we want to echo the fact that our spiritual deliverance is the most important. Remember, we need to worship in spirit and in truth. So as we come before God this morning, and we'll turn to Him in prayer in just a moment, let us just have a sense of realism, a sense of true awe, that we are coming before God to worship Him for who He is and how magnificent He is. So let's bow our heads as we commit the service to God, and just give Him thanks for who He is. Father, we adore You this morning, Lord. We lift up Your name and we exalt You, Lord. But at the same time, Father, we come before You lowly and sinful. We really do need You, Lord. We need You each and every day to guide us, to guide our lives, to make straight our paths, Lord. We know how faithful You are. And so, Father, would we never come to You out of pretense, but would we come knowing that You are a gracious God and You look after Your children, Lord. So whatever our frustrations have been from the week past, I pray that we would forget about those, or that we would just lift up our issues and our problems to You, Lord, knowing that You will always answer us for our own good. And so as we turn to Your word this morning, may it be a time where we really just grapple with Your truth, where we grasp Your truth, and understand it, plant it deep within our hearts, Lord, so that we may use it to raise our kids, to love our wives, to love our friends, to love our brothers and sisters, to love our enemies, Lord, so that we may have a real and practical faith, a faith which shows that we love the Lord Jesus with all our hearts, and that our lives are an expression of worship, Lord, as we come before You, whether in singing, or whether to listen and to hear Your word and to act on it, Lord. We know that all of our worship is to be done in spirit and in truth. And so, Holy Spirit, we pray that Your power would be made known in us this morning as we go through the passage in Corinthians. We thank You, Father, for all that we have. It all comes from You. And we know that nothing happens without You knowing, Lord. Nothing takes You by surprise. And so may we each rest in Your sovereignty, Lord. Through a very troubled time, may people look at our lives and see that we trust, in spite of the panic that is going on around us with regards to COVID-19. We pray this in Jesus' precious name. Amen. Just one other thing I wanted to mention is, obviously, the passage that we are looking at this morning is the Lord's Supper. And it's been very difficult for us to be able to, at least near impossible at this point, for us to meet as a church around the Lord's Supper. And so I just want to say that if you want to have the Lord's Supper, today and take the Lord's Supper and observe the Lord's Supper, you are free to do that. We are commanded to do that. So if you want to take some time and do that, you're more than welcome. And I can just encourage you to do it in a way which is biblical, and a way which just shows a true heart after God. And enjoy the service. We're going to sing now. And so don't be afraid to stand up and make a noise to the Lord. My daughter always loves the time when we come to actual singing. So yeah. Please stand and just worship God as we sing to Him this morning.
To Him, the God of light, who formed the mountain. Thank you, the Father. now seated at your table, Jesus, thank you.
Well, a very good morning to you, church. I just want to say up front that I'm so pleased to be preaching again. It's been a real blessing for me this week to once again spend time in the Word preparing. And so I'm excited to be preaching again. I also want to take the opportunity to say thank you for giving me the last 2 weeks off. It's been a real blessing to us as a family to be able to have the time together, to have the 2 weeks together with Emery. And also just as parents to be able to weather the storm of that the first few weeks of a new baby. Now all the parents know what I'm talking about. So thank you for giving us the time as a family over the last 2 weeks. I must say, every time we come to Sunday, I am both uplifted and encouraged by the services, but I'm also saddened because something is desperately missing from our lives. It's not what we're doing now, able to meet online, it's wonderful that we have the technology to do this, but this is not what God intended. The Bible is clear that he intended for the body to be together, to be interacting with each other. And that's his purpose for his church, specifically the local church. And so while we are able to still study the scriptures together and praise and worship together, this isn't what God intended. He intended us to be together. And so I want to say I desperately miss you guys and genuinely would love to hear from you. And so if you have some news to share, if you have some concerns to share, if you would like to pray, if you'd just like to chat, please feel free to text me, phone me, get hold of me. Dee and I would both dearly love to hear from you. We miss you guys. Well, today we are back in 1 Corinthians. We're going back into our study in 1 Corinthians, and we are going to be studying a passage of scripture that if you've been in church for any period of time, you will be very familiar with. We're in 1 Corinthians chapter 11. We're studying from verse 17 to 34. And Paul here is talking about the Lord's Supper. So if you've been certainly in our church, in more of a Baptist church consistently, you will have heard this passage read many times, or at least a portion of this passage read many times as we go to the Lord's table together, as we celebrate communion together as a church. Today we're going to look at this passage in its context and hopefully gain a deeper understanding of what was happening in Corinth and why Paul shared what he shared about the Lord's Supper. So if I could ask you to please turn with me to 1 Corinthians chapter 11. We're going to start in verse 17. And I'll read the passage and then I'll pray for our time in the Word together. Paul says, "But in the following instructions, I do not commend you, because when you come together, it is not for the better, but for the worse. For in the first place, when you come together as a church, I hear that there are divisions among you, and I believe it in part, for there must be factions among you in order that those who are genuine among you may be recognized. When you come together, it is not the Lord's Supper that you eat, for in eating, each one goes ahead with his own meal. One goes hungry, another gets drunk. What? Do you not have houses to eat or drink in? Or do you despise the church of God and humiliate those who have nothing? What shall I say to you? Shall I commend you in this? No, I will not. For I received from the Lord what I also delivered to you, that the Lord Jesus, on the night when he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it, and said, 'This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me.' In the same way, also he took the cup after supper, saying, 'This is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it, in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat this bread and drink the cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. Whoever therefore eats the bread or drinks the cup of the Lord in an unworthy manner will be guilty concerning the body and blood of the Lord. Let a person examine himself then, and so eat of the bread and drink the cup, for anyone who eats and drinks without discerning the body eats and drinks judgment on himself. That is why many of you are weak and ill, and some have died. But if we judge ourselves truly, we would not be judged. But when we are judged by the Lord, we are disciplined, so that we may not be condemned along with the world. So then, my brothers, when you come together to eat, wait for one another. If one is hungry, let him eat at home, so that when you come together, it will not be for judgment. About the other things, I will give you directions when I come. Let's pray. Father God, we do thank you for your word. We thank you for the incredibly practical instruction we have in passages like this. We thank you, Father, today for Jesus' death on the cross. We thank you for what he achieved for us, taking on our sin, paying for our sin, taking the full wrath poured out on him. Father, we thank you that we are free. We thank you that Jesus gave us the Lord's Supper, that we might remember what he has done for us and what he has achieved for us. And so, Father, I pray that as we study this passage this morning, that you would be opening our eyes to the fullness of truth. I pray, Father, that you would be convicting our hearts where we have approached the table in an unworthy manner. Father, I pray that you would be convicting us and changing us, Father. I pray that we would realize the weightiness of what it is that we celebrate when we partake in the Lord's Supper. Father, build your church, we pray. Change us evermore into the likeness of your Son. Father, I pray that we would be holy and set apart for you and you alone in this world. Amen. Well, we've got a lot to get through today, so we're going to jump right in. Verse 17, Paul says, "But in the following instructions, I do not commend you." Now, this is in stark contrast to what he had said to them in verse 2 of chapter 11, where he did commend them for remembering him and the traditions that he had passed on to them. Here he says, "I cannot commend you." What we're going to see, rather than a commendation, Paul in fact gives them a strong rebuke. He says, "Because when you come together, it is not for the better, but for the worse." This is quite a confronting statement. Paul says, basically, it is better for them if they don't meet, because when they meet, it is worse off for them. It's quite extreme. Their behavior has become so destructive that Paul says it would be better off for them if they didn't meet. Now, what is it that could be so serious that Paul would say it would be better for them if they didn't meet? He tells us in verse 18, he says, "For in the first place, when you come together as a church, I hear that there are divisions among you." Divisions among them. It is the divisions in the church that are so negative in Paul's mind that it would be better for them not to meet at all. Their divisions, as we will see as we go through the passage, are based in their selfishness. Their selfish behavior and their self-seeking behavior have further divided the church along what would probably have been natural cultural divides, but they have further divided the church to the extent that Paul says it would be better if they never met at all. Brothers and sisters, let's not miss this. What Paul is saying to them is equally as relevant to us, that there are selfish behaviors in the church, when we behave in a selfish manner and in an unholy manner towards each other, bringing division in the church, it would be better off for us if we never met at all. Paul says, there are divisions among you. He says, and I believe it in part. Now, he realizes that all reports come with an element of exaggeration. And so he is probably here saying that when he says, I believe it in part, that he recognizes that there is some exaggeration in the report that he has received, but there's also some truth. Now, very quickly before we move on, this is found in the section of the letter where Paul is addressing the questions that have been posed to him by the believers in Corinth. But it seems here for this section of scripture that he actually pauses in answering their questions. And he addresses something that he has been told, that he's been told about them, not that they have asked him. But it's so important that he pauses here as he's addressing from chapter 11 through to the end of chapter 14, the gathering of believers. They are taking communion or the Lord's Supper as part of their gathering. And so it's apt that he would address it in this section. But this is not a question that's been asked of him, but rather an issue that he's identified in the church that has been reported to him that he's now addressing. He He says in verse 19, "For there must be factions among you, in order that those who are genuine among you may be recognized." Now, I find this to be an incredibly interesting statement. Factions or divisions in the church are necessary. That's what Paul is saying. It is necessary that there be factions or divisions in the church. There are two main interpretations of this verse. The one is that Paul is using sarcasm. In other words, he's saying, obviously, there must be divisions. How else could we possibly know who has the strongest argument or the greatest knowledge? And the other interpretation is that Paul is stating a principal truth here in how God brings to the fore those who are genuinely his children, how he identifies in the church those who are genuinely his children, and also how he exposes those who are not. I would argue strongly for the second interpretation. And we see throughout Scripture that it is through persecution, trial, and suffering that that our profession of faith is tested, and that the genuineness of that profession is is established. Division in the church is one of the hardest things that I personally have ever faced. I'll tell you that much. The New Testament is full of warnings against false teachers. We clearly see that the outcome of the false teachers is that they separate the church. They separate the true and the false believers. God, in his sovereignty, uses even false teachers to build his true church. Now, as I said, the New Testament is full of warnings against false teachers, but I'm just going to pick out two from the New Testament to read to you that illustrate this point that the false teachers will draw away those Christians who are not genuine. 2 Peter 2 verse 1 says this: "But the false prophets," talking about the false prophets in the Old Testament, "but the false prophets also arose among the people, just as there will be false teachers among you who will secretly bring in destructive heresies, even denying the master who bought them, bringing upon themselves swift destruction. And many will follow their sensuality, and because of them, the way of truth will be blasphemed." Many will follow these false teachers. 1 John 2, verse 19, is talking about people leaving the church. And he says this. He says, "They went out from us, but they were not of us. For if they had been of us, they would have continued with us. But they went out that it might become plain that they all are not of us." In other words, it is shown through people who leave the church through division and through false teaching that they never really were part of God's true church in the beginning. The Old Testament speaks of this as well, very interestingly. I'll read Deuteronomy 13, verses 1 to 4. It says this: "If a prophet or a dreamer of dreams arises among you and gives you a sign or a wonder, and the sign or wonder that he tells you comes to pass," and pause there and quickly say that that was the litmus test that they had been given to see whether a prophet or a dreamer was in fact genuine. If what they said came to pass, it was proof that they were genuine. So this is saying if a prophet or a dreamer comes along and they prophesy and what they have prophesied comes to pass, in other words, they are seen to be genuine. "And if he says, 'Let us go after other gods which you have not known and let us serve them,' you shall not listen to the words of that prophet or that dreamer of dreams. For the Lord your God is testing you to know whether you love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul." God sent these false prophets to test his people to see whether in fact they loved him with all of their heart and all of their soul. Remember, the greatest commandment is that we too would love the Lord our God with all of our heart, soul, mind, and strength. And so God sent these false prophets in the Old Testament to test his people to see whether they genuinely loved him. Likewise, Peter says, false teachers, in the verse I read in 2 Peter chapter 2, false teachers will rise up in the church to test whether in fact we are genuine in our profession of faith, whether we love the Lord and whether we know his word. Going back to Deuteronomy 13 in verse 4, it says this: "You shall walk after the Lord your God and fear him and keep his commandments and obey his voice, and you shall serve him and hold fast to him." In other words, we combat false teachers by knowing God's word and holding fast to him and obeying him. That hasn't changed from the Old Testament to today. Division in the church is one of the ways in which God sanctifies and cleans out his church. Division in the church is one of the ways in which God reveals those who are genuine. Now, we experienced something of this in the church in Thailand. In the last year that we were there, we had some people who rose up and sought to bring division in the church. They actually stated that they were wanting to take the church back and get rid of the people who didn't think the same as them. Now, through this, it was amazing to see how other individuals in the church stood up and stood up against these people and stood on the truth of God's word. As they sought to bring division, what happened was that God brought to the fore those people in the church who were genuine, who loved him, who loved his word, and who stood on his truth. It became as clear as day to see who the genuine believers were and who were not genuine believers in this situation. Leon Morris, one of the theologians who wrote a commentary on 1 Corinthians, he said this: "It is only as those who choose in a self-willed manner make their appearance that those who have God's approval are made manifest." God shows the genuineness of our faith through divisions in the church. And this is something that we need to understand and recognize. This does not, however, mean that we go out and seek division. We don't look for opportunities to be divisive, as if to say we're doing God's work here, because ultimately this is building God's church. That would be a very foolish thing for us to do. In Matthew 18 and verse 7, when Jesus is talking about temptation to sin, he says this. He says, "It is necessary that temptations come." Very similar thing to what Paul has just said. It's necessary that temptations come, but woe to the one by whom the temptation comes. And then Jesus goes on to say it would be better if he had a millstone tied around his neck and thrown into a lake. Romans 12 verse 18 says, "If possible, so far as it depends on you, live peaceably with all." It is necessary that there are divisions in the church in order that those who are genuine might be made manifest. But it is not our job to go out and look for division. Division will come. It is our job, as far as possible, to live peaceably with all. But Paul's statement is clear, that God uses this to build his church. Now he gives, moving on to verse 20, he gives a description of what's happening in the church in Corinth. He says, "When you come together, it is not the Lord's Supper that you eat." Paul starts with what must have been a very stinging clarification for the believers. What you are doing is not actually partaking in the Lord's Supper. That might be what you intended, but you have missed the mark by so far that that is not what's happening. He says, "For in eating, each one goes ahead with his own meal. One goes hungry and another gets drunk." Here's a picture of what was most likely happening in the church in Corinth. The believers met on the first day of the week, as this was the day that Jesus rose. And so this was the day in which the early church met. It's still the day on which we meet, the first day of the week. This, however, was a day of work for the people in the early church. And so the believers would gather in the evenings after work, so that at the end of the day's work, all of the believers could come together. Perhaps as a way of encouraging fellowship, especially with the time of the meeting in the evenings, the believers would share a full meal together when they met. It was called the Love Feast, and it's spoken about in other of the New Testament books. It was something like a bring and share or a potluck meal, where they would all bring food and put it together and they would eat. And once the meal was finished, once the actual meal was finished, they would then break bread and share in the Lord's Supper. Now, it seems as though the wealthy people provided the majority of the food for this love feast, for this meal. They had the means, and from the information we have, it seems as though they brought the food, or at least the majority of the food, to these gatherings. And on the surface, you would say that this seems like a wonderful act of Christian love. But we get a little bit more into what Paul is describing here. You see, there were three, essentially, there were three social classes of people in the early church. There were the wealthy people who were very free and were able to come and go as they pleased. They were not restrained by working hours or duties. And so they would typically arrive first to these gatherings. Then there was what was essentially the middle class, people who were free but still had work restrictions, and they would join the wealthy elite after their work had finished, so after work hours. And then there were the slaves, and the slaves were bound to the service of their master as their master pleased. So if the master of the slaves had a dinner party that evening, then the slaves would be required to stay at the house and serve until his dinner party was finished and his guests were gone, probably even until the house had been cleaned up. They would typically be the last to join this gathering, and they would only be able to join once all their work had been done. What was happening then is that the poorer people would arrive, and the scene that they would find is that the food had all been eaten, the wine had all been drunk, there was no food for them, and there were a bunch of drunk people lying around. And so what it seemed was happening is that the wealthy people were rushing to the gatherings as early as they could and feasting on all of their food without any consideration for those poorer people who would come later. Paul's response to this is indignation. He is angry. He says, "What?" And he tears into them with a series of pointed questions. He says, "Do you not have houses to eat or drink in? Or do you despise the church of God and humiliate those who have nothing? What shall I say to you? Shall I commend you in this? No, I will not." Their actions expose their utter selfishness. It exposes their disregard for God's church. In fact, Paul says that their selfish behavior could be mistaken for hatred of the church. They humiliate the poor. Paul's final statement is emphatic. "What shall I say? Shall I commend you? No, I will not," he says. Paul goes on from here at this point, after describing what is really an ugly situation. He goes on to give one of the most amazing descriptions of the Lord's Supper that we have. It's wonderful to see what Paul is doing here. In correcting them, he has exposed their error. Now he brings them back to the truth as he taught them, the apostles' teaching, the very word of God. And then he's going to go on to make applications and corrections to their specific situation in light of the truth. This is good pastoral counsel modeled for us by the Apostle Paul. Starting in verse 23, he gives a reminder of the significance and the symbolism of the Lord's Supper. He says, "For I received from the Lord what I also delivered to you." Now, this is generally considered to be the earliest account we have of the Lord's Supper. This letter to the Corinthians was in fact written before any of the Gospels. And so even though it comes after the Gospels in our New Testament, it was penned before they were written. So Paul hasn't gone to any of the letters written by the Gospel writers and copied their account of the Lord's Supper. He is in fact giving this as his own account of the Lord's Supper, as he received directly from Christ himself. This is not a man-made institution. Paul is not coming up with this on his own. This was revelation received directly from the Lord Jesus Christ himself. Some people are unsure of how to understand this because Paul was obviously not one of Jesus' disciples. He was not with him in his time on earth, and he was certainly not present at the final supper when Jesus initiated the Lord's Supper. But we also know that Paul, from his writings, that Paul did receive firsthand revelation from Jesus himself. We have multiple times in Acts where we are told of Christ appearing to Paul in Acts 18, verse 9, when Paul is in Corinth. We studied that several months ago. Acts 22, 18, Acts 23, 11, Acts 27, verses 23 to 25. In the 15th chapter of 1 Corinthians, Paul talks about the resurrection, and the certainty of Christ's resurrection through the proof of eyewitnesses. And he includes himself in that list as an eyewitness in verse 8. He talks about Christ appearing to him. He says, last of all, as to one untimely born, he appeared also to me. Perhaps the most definitive statement on the matter is found in Galatians 1, where in verses 11 and 12, Paul says this. He says, for I would have you know, brothers, that the gospel that was preached by me is not man's gospel, for I did not receive it from any man, nor was I taught it, but I received it through revelation of Jesus Christ. In other words, he received it directly from Jesus himself. So Paul passed on what he received from Jesus, that the Lord Jesus, on the night when he was betrayed, pause there for a second. The significance of this cannot be missed. Paul is addressing the selfishness and the division in the church in Corinth, specifically around the Lord's Supper. And he points out that Jesus instituted this supper at the very time when Judas was engaged in a selfish betrayal of the Lord, a betrayal that would bring deep division. Jesus was putting in place a reminder of his death, his selfless love poured out in order that his church might be built and in order that the poor might be elevated. This was happening on the night he was betrayed, and this is in stark contrast to the Corinthian selfishness which despises the church and humiliates the poor. Picking up at the end of verse 23, Jesus took, on the night that he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, this is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me. This is my body, Jesus says. His body was beaten. His body was pierced. His body was crucified. He himself bore our sins in his body. Upon him, God poured out the fullness of his wrath. On the cross, Jesus drank the cup of God's wrath down to the dregs for all who would be saved. And who is that? Well, brothers and sisters, that's us. If we are in Christ, that's us. Jesus says, this is my body, which is for you. Which is for you. What happened to Jesus's body on the cross is for us. He suffered for us. He was brutally killed for us. More than that, he took the fullness of God's wrath for us and for our sins. There was a purpose in his suffering, and that purpose was freedom for us. This is what Jesus has done for us. And he says that we should do this, take communion in remembrance of him. So do this is in the present continuous, and it's a command that we are to keep doing this in the present continuous. Keep doing this in remembrance of him. Remember, it's a command. If you are not partaking in the Lord's Supper, if you for years have not shared in the Lord's Supper, you're being disobedient to your Lord. This is a command that he has given us. And he says to do it in remembrance of him. Now, this is interesting. To a Jew, the act of remembering was to bring into full consciousness, into full conscious thought, that which was being remembered. So when Jesus says that we are to remember him, we're not to simply think about the cross and then move on. We are to bring into full conscious thought all that was achieved on the cross, all that Jesus took upon himself in his suffering, all that he gained for us in our freedom. I would go a step further and say we are to call consciously to mind and meditate on all that Jesus achieved in his life as well. We sang about this a little bit earlier today. Think about these lyrics. What love, my God, could hold you to the tree to bear the overwhelming debt for me? We are to call the fullness of this to our mind when we partake in the Lord's Supper, and this is what Jesus has commanded us to do. In the same way, he also took the cup after supper, saying, this cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. In the same way, that he took the bread was shared during the meal. We're told now the cup was taken after the supper. And in the same way, he took the cup and he made it a symbol of what he was about to do in his death. He said, this cup is the new covenant in my blood. The Old Testament is full of God's promises of a new covenant that he will make with his people in the prophets, the books of the prophets. One of which is found in Jeremiah 31, verses 31 to 34. Let me read it to you quickly. The Lord says this, "Behold, the days are coming, declares the Lord, when I will make a new covenant with the house of Israel and the house of Judah, not like the covenant that I made with their fathers on the day when I took them by the hand to bring them out of the land of Egypt. My covenant that they broke, though I was their husband, declares the Lord. For this is the covenant that I will make with the house of Israel after those days, declares the Lord. I will put my law within them, and I will write it on their hearts, and I will be their God, and they shall be my people. And no longer shall each one teach his neighbor and each his brother, saying, know the Lord, for they shall all know me. From the least of them to the greatest, declares the Lord, for I will forgive their iniquity, and I will remember their sin no more." This is an amazing promise of what God is going to do for us, for his people, the Jews, but also grafting in the Gentiles in the new covenant. Jesus says that the cup signifies the new covenant in his blood. When a covenant was made in the Old Testament, it was sealed or ratified in blood. And we have a picture of this when God makes his covenant with Abraham. Abraham takes the five animals and he splits them in half and he lays them in two rows with a path in between. And this was how a covenant was done. And what would happen is the people who were making the promises to each other, who were covenanting to each other, would walk between the animals and they would say, if I break my oath, may the same thing be done to me as these animals. And so the blood was the sign, it was the seal, sorry, on the covenant. Now, that verse in Jeremiah speaks about God's covenant that he made with his people when they left Israel. Sorry, when they left Egypt. As you'll remember, the night before the Israelites leave, God says that he will pass over and kill the firstborn of every house unless they slaughter a lamb and paint its blood on the doorpost. That blood was the seal of the promise that God would pass over their house. But now God says, I'm going to make another covenant with my people because that covenant they broke. And this is the new covenant. The Old Testament covenants were sealed with the blood of animals. The New Testament, the new covenant, is sealed with the blood of Jesus Christ. The Old Testament covenants were all a foreshadowing of what was to come. And they are all fulfilled in Jesus and his death on the cross. And so God seals this promise that he has made. And you can read several promises pointing to the new covenant in the books of Ezekiel, Isaiah, and Jeremiah. And God has sealed those promises in the blood of Jesus Christ on the cross. And Jesus again says, do this in remembrance of me. Verse 26, for as often as you eat this bread and drink the cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. I love this. This is not just looking back. It's not just looking back and remembering, but it's also looking forward and proclaiming a proclamation that Christ will return. This is our hope in all circumstances that we have been bought by the blood of Christ, that we are sealed by the blood of Christ, and that he will return in victory. The Lord who paid for our sins and won our freedom and defeated death on our behalf is coming again. One day he is coming in power and he will rule for all eternity and us with him. Very interestingly, this word proclaim is a word that is exclusively used throughout the Bible and throughout the New Testament to describe an activity exercised towards people, not an activity exercised towards God. In other words, we don't make proclamations to God, we make proclamations to each other. When we take communion, we are proclaiming to one another the Lord's death. It is, in a sense, an acted out sermon that we proclaim to one another every time we share in the Lord's Supper. Paul now moves on to the practical outcome of this awesome truth for the Corinthians and their situation and for us as well. Because of the incredible weight and significance of what Paul has shared, we must approach the Lord's table with care and reverence. Verse 27, whoever therefore eats the bread and drinks the cup of the Lord in an unworthy manner will be guilty concerning the body and blood of the Lord. Very importantly, this is talking about coming in an unworthy manner, not talking about us being unworthy people. We're all unworthy. If this was a command not to come to the Lord's table as an unworthy person, then none of us could come. None of us could partake in the Lord's Supper. We are all unworthy. But this is not talking about who we are, but how we approach the table. We are not to approach the table in an unworthy manner. And this is serious because Paul goes on to say that if we do approach in an unworthy manner, that we are guilty of the body and the blood of the Lord. So what does it mean? What is it to approach in an unworthy manner? I think verses 28 and 29 shed some light on this. 28, let a person examine himself then, and so eat of the bread and drink of the cup. It would be unworthy if we came to the Lord's table unprepared. We must first examine ourselves. We must first examine our lives. We must first examine our sin. We are to examine our sin and confess it. I would even go so far as to say that Sunday morning during the service is too late to start examining your life before you take communion. This is something that should be done in advance. You know, if you're part of our church, when we are scheduled to have communion. And I would say that you need to be preparing yourself in the week ahead, examining your life, examining your heart, examining your sin. Becoming a Christian means acknowledging that we are fallen, sinful people. And so examining our sin should not be something new to us. We have already, in accepting Christ, acknowledged that we are sinful, wicked people and that we are fallen. So when we call to mind our sin, it shouldn't be something that is new and shocking to us. This is the reason that Christ died for us. And so we should, before coming to the table, examine ourselves and repent. Confess and repent of how we have sinned. Coming to the table to partake and remember Christ's death while we are harboring sin that he died to oppose would make us guilty. Let's not turn a blind eye to the sin. Let's not harbor sin in our lives, but let's acknowledge it as sin and confess it. That's the reason that Jesus died for us. That is the reason we remember his death in communion. Verse 29, for anyone who eats and drinks without discerning the body eats and drinks judgment on himself. Now, there's some debate as to whether this, without discerning the body, whether this talks about thinking about the body of Jesus on the cross or the body of Jesus as in the church. Now, I don't think that these two necessarily should be divorced from each other. Jesus died on the cross for his church. To consider Christ on the cross is to consider selfless love for his church. With that in mind, I would say it would be unworthy if we were to partake without recalling to conscious mind, without recalling to our conscious thought, Jesus and his death on the cross. I would go further, as I did earlier, to say that we should also include his life and all he did for us in his life. When we partake, therefore, it must not be a mindless ritual, but rather a time of engaging our minds fully on Jesus Christ, his life, his death, and his resurrection. I would also say that it would be unworthy to partake without considering the church. This is really the main thrust of Paul's argument in this passage, that these people have been partaking in the Lord's Supper without consideration for the other believers, and therefore what they are doing is in no way partaking in the Lord's Supper, which is what Paul has said. And so I would also say that where Paul calls for us to be discerning of the body, it is definitely talking about our fellow believers, specifically the local church that we belong to. In other words, the brothers and sisters that we regularly meet with and walk through life with and with whom we share in the Lord's Supper. Do we harbor sin or resentment against anyone in the church? How can we, when we consider our Lord dying on the cross for us, while we were still his enemies? Do we actively use the gifts that God has given us for the edification of his church? If not, how could we possibly say that we love the church that Jesus died for? Do we, in obedience to Christ, both seek correction from fellow believers as well as give correction in love? Do we look for opportunities to meet the physical needs of our brothers and sisters who are less well off than we are? Do we strive to show hospitality and love to each other? If we're not doing these things, how can we possibly partake in the Lord's Supper in a worthy manner? These are what Jesus died for, not just your individual salvation, but our collective redemption and holiness. To partake without considering Jesus and without considering his church is to partake in an unworthy manner and to bring judgment on ourselves. Remember, we are all unworthy. So it doesn't mean that we have to be perfect in these things before we can come to the Lord's table. Rather, that we are to consider whether or not these things are important to us as they are to Christ. If they're not important to us, we have no business partaking in the Lord's Supper. These are essentially what Jesus died for, the salvation and the building of his church. It should be of utmost importance to us. The word here that is used for judgment, that we eat and drink judgment on ourselves, means chastisement. It's not talking about condemnation, but it's rather talking about correction. It means discipline. And Paul goes on to expound on that in verse 30. He says, "That is why many of you are weak and ill, and some have died." Do you want to know how important it is to God that we approach communion with seriousness and in a worthy manner? The flippant approach of the people in Corinth had been the cause of sickness and even death for some of them. I want to say that this is an act of gracious discipline on the part of God. How on earth can you say that sickness and death is gracious discipline on the part of God? Well, we know that God disciplines those he loves, and he disciplines us in order to change us. If we will not change, he may send the ultimate discipline, which is death. Do you know what death means for the Christian? Heaven. I can think of worse disciplines than that. The unfathomable love of God is often judged as cruelty by ignorant men. But it is in his incredible love for us that God disciplines us. Verse 31, "But if we judge ourselves truly, we would not be judged." Here's the remedy. "If we would thoroughly search ourselves and confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us our sins." It is to our great benefit for us to search ourselves and to identify our wickedness and our sin before we approach the table. It is to our great benefit to ask God to reveal to us those areas of sin in our lives that we might be blind to. The Christian life is one of acknowledging our weakness. We bring this to the cross every time we repent. There is no greater reminder of this than when we partake in the Lord's Supper. Verse 32, "But when we are judged by the Lord, we are disciplined so that we may not be condemned along with the world. Even when we don't truly judge ourselves, if we belong to God, He graciously judges us and disciplines us. As I said, how could God's judgment and discipline be good for us? Very simply put, He does it now rather than later. It is far better that God would judge us now and discipline us now than that He would leave us now and judge us later, along with the rest of the world, whose judgment is, whose verdict is guilty and their punishment is eternal. What we have here is actually a wonderful promise from God through the Apostle Paul. If we are truly one of God's children, we will never be condemned with the rest of the world, but rather disciplined. Let us be thankful for the Lord's discipline in our lives, because it shows that we are legitimate children. In Malachi, we read this, that God says, "Jacob I have loved, but Esau I hated." Do you know how God showed His love for Jacob? He disciplines him. Throughout Jacob's life, we read of God disciplining him. The opposite is true of Esau. God shows His hatred for Esau in that He never disciplines him. He rather allows Esau to continue in his own sinful way. Brothers and sisters, let us not despise the discipline of the Lord, because this is God's love towards us who are His children. Paul says in verse 33, "So then, my brothers, when you come together to eat, wait for one another. If anyone is hungry, let him eat at home, so that when you come together, it will not be for judgment." In other words, when you come together, don't rush in and thinking just of yourself. Don't rush in and eat this meal and finish all the food and drink all of the wine before everyone is assembled. If you're that hungry that you can't wait, rather eat at home before you come. This is some practical advice, very specific to the Corinthian situation. But the principle here that we need to consider is this. Think about other people. Don't just do what is beneficial to you. This is kind of going back to what Paul had been talking about in chapter 8. Think about other people. I heard this great acronym, JOY. Jesus, others, you. We naturally think of ourselves first in everything, but true joy is found in serving our King, our Lord, Jesus Christ, serving others, and only thinking of ourselves after that. Anything else is unworthy of the death of Jesus on the cross. He says, "So that when you come together, it will not be for judgment." In other words, by considering others, and not just ourselves, this judgment that we've spoken about is therefore removed. We are now approaching the Lord's table in a worthy manner. And Paul ends with this statement. He says, "About other things, I will give you directions when I come." So he's basically saying, "I will give you further instruction in person." But what he penned is what we have. This is God's instruction to us as a church, certainly about sharing in the Lord's Supper, but even about how we are to live as believers in community. Let's pray. Father God, I thank you for your word. I thank you for the faithfulness of the Apostle Paul as he addressed this issue in the church in Corinth. It is so confronting to us to read this, because we are selfish people who are so preoccupied with thinking about ourselves. Father, I pray that you would show us areas in our lives where we are selfish. Show us areas in our lives where we hold on to things and our own will instead of what you have called us to and your will. Father, I pray that you would discipline us where we need to be disciplined. I pray that you would reveal areas of sin where we might not yet see them. Father, I pray that you would give us an understanding of the incredible significance of what it is that we celebrate when we partake in the Lord's Supper. Father, I pray that you would continue to build your church here in Moy River. And I pray that as we live out the truth that we have studied this morning, that it would be through us and through our lives, that your gospel is shared through the way in which we live as well as through what we say. Father, may your name be glorified in us and in your church. May your church be built. Father, I pray that your kingdom would come here on earth as it is in heaven. We love you in Jesus' name. Amen.
Behold the Lamb who bears our sins away, slain for us. And we remember the promise made that all who come in faith find forgiveness at the cross. And so we share in this bread of life, and we drink of his sacrifice as a sign of our bonds of peace around the table of the King. Body of our Savior Jesus Christ torn for you. Eat and remember the wounds that heal, the death that brings us life, paid the price to make us one. Every stain of sin shed for you. Drink and remember, he drank this cup that all may enter in to receive the life of God. So we share in this bread of life. Table love.